speaker is the Associate Professor of English Department, University of Calicut, Dr. K.M. Sherrif.
Translation studies is one of the least developed disciplines in Indian literatures. There were no attempts to theorize translation in India's classical literatures. Unlike in the West, translation was not recognized as a category in literary discourse. Equivalence or faithfulness were not cherished ideals in literary translation in India as it was in the West. In India, the tradition was of literary texts, including the epics Ramayana and Mahabharata, being freely rendered in rewriting. These renderings were considered not translations, but original writings. Faithfulness was an ideal only for knowledge texts like Ashtanga Hridaya and Arthashastra. The difference was not theorized. Perhaps the theorists thought it was too obvious a difference to be theorized. Translation was discussed in the Western literary system at least from the days of the Roman Empire. Apart from faithfulness and equivalence, the discussion centered around the notion of meaning and its faithful transference in translation. In practice, there were, however, many instances in which the translation moved away drastically from the original. Centuries later, in 1861, Matthew Arnold wrote an essay on translating Homer. Arnold argued that a translation of poetry in particular, should produce in its readers the same effect as the original work produced on its readers. The traditional preoccupation with equivalence, faithfulness, and meaning continued well into the middle of the 20th century, till the advent of structural linguistics. J.C. Catford's book, The Linguistic Theory of Translation, published in 1965, tried to evade the question of equivalence altogether. For the first time in the history of translation studies, Catford claimed that equivalence was something that was arrived at through general consensus or relative perception rather than an absolute concept. She stated that equivalence occurs only when any target language text or portion of text is observed on a particular occasion to be the equivalent of a given source language text or portion of text. A radical breakthrough in translation theory came in the 80s of the 20th century with the emergence of the rewriting culture paradigm in translation studies. Translation was declared an activity that involved two cultures rather than two languages. André Lefebvre's proposition that translation was only a form of rewriting came to be widely accepted. The rewriting was the result of aesthetic and ideological divergence between the source and target cultures. Lefebvre distinguished between the constraints and manipulations of the translator. The constraints were those elements in the source culture, aesthetic and ideological, which posed challenges to the translator. A translator can also manipulate the source text to fit into the ideology and aesthetics of the target culture, or he can do it in the service of an ideology or aesthetics he has personally embraced. Lawrence Minuti distinguished between domesticating and foreignizing translations. A foreignizing translation was one which looked distinctly like a translation. It would try to stay close to the source text. A domesticating translation, on the other hand, would domesticate or assimilate the text into the ideological aesthetic matrix of the target culture. Till the emergence of the rewriting culture paradigm in translation studies, it was literary translation that was overwhelmingly taken up for discussion. However, it was soon realized that literary translation constituted only a small portion of the total volume of translation produced in many cultures. Venuti calculated this as less than 4%. The overwhelming majority of the translations were technical or official in nature. Probably there are many more translations of advertisements in the media than translations of novels or poems. Machine translation or computer-aided translation has virtually taken over technical translation in Europe and America with a fairly acceptable rate of success. Intersemiotic translation, especially translations in the audio-visual media, began to be widely discussed from the beginning of the 90s of the last century. several significant works on interpreting and the forms of screen translation like dubbing, subtitling and voiceover were published during the next two decades. It was this engagement with the audio-visual media and intersemiotic translation that led to the emergence of a new discipline called adaptation studies. When the term adaptation began to be widely used in translation studies, it only signified the cinematic renderings of literary texts. But it soon took on hold all forms of rewriting, cutting across modes, genres and media. In taking on hold rewriting of all kinds of texts, adaptation studies is the closest to what can be described as a unified theory on culture, paralleling Albert Einstein's unaccomplished vision of a unified theory of forces in physics. In any case, adaptation studies has extended the limits of translation studies immensely. What is remarkable is that although the theorization is new, the practice, both in the West and in India, goes back hundreds of years. Cultures in the West and the East have recorded the emergence of several forms of adaptations in their history. In Kerala, both the traditional performing arts like Kathakali and Kootu and the modern narrative performing art called Kathaprasangam represent adaptations of different kinds. Adaptation studies also allow us to reposition certain texts which we traditionally used to call original texts. A painting by Leonardo da Vinci thus becomes an adaptation of a biblical narrative context. A raga in Hindustani music becomes an adaptation of a myth or a legend. Although adaptation studies has concentrated largely on intersemiotic rewriting, especially rewriting for the theater and the screen, it has also tackled intra-linguistic rewriting, often involving explicitly literary texts. John Milton, one of the theorists of the discipline, has given the following list, which is not exhaustive: recontextualization, tradaptation, spin-off, reduction, simplification, condensation, abridgment, special version, reworking, offshoot, transformation, remediation, and revision. There are some notions which have been widely accepted in adaptation studies. The binary of original and rewriting has been discarded. Instead, one talks of one or more antecedent texts from which the rewriting or adaptation is launched. Several schools of literary theory in the 20th century had already rejected the notion of originality. No text is independent of influences from the past, which means that all writing is rewriting. The antecedent text or texts are not necessarily privileged. What is significant is the network of intertextuality that texts enter into. Thomas Leach talks of an unlimited intertextuality in which each text floats upon a sea of earlier texts from which it cannot help borrowing. Linda Hutchin has pointed out that the vast majority of texts we encounter are adaptations, more than 75% of texts in popular culture. In a culture teeming with popular texts, the intertextual relationship with other texts is obvious. Hutchin attributes this abundance of adaptations to the dynamics of investment and profit. Cultural productions stick to time-tested formulas for success. Occasionally, an enterprising film director or the producer of a feature program on TV comes up with an innovative idea. It may click or fail in the box office depending upon a number of factors. The impacting of technology on cultural production from the last decade of the 20th century has made a new mode of constructing texts possible. Traditionally, all texts could be neatly classified into two: telling texts or narrative texts, and showing text or visual media text. A third type of text is now recognized: interactive text. Texts which are actually constructed through the interaction of the reader or player with the textual material. Video games and certain forms of e-literature come under this category. Almost all video games are adaptations which draw from popular or canonized literature, folklore or mythology. The notion of unlimited intertextuality may also indicate the freedom for unlimited rewriting or adaptation. What prevents the play of this unlimited intertextuality is the copyright regime. Copyright confers ownership rights on the author of a text, which entitles him or her to exclusive rights even on the rewriting of the text in any form. But unlimited intertextuality is thousands of years old. Copyright has been in existence only for the last 3 centuries. So the future of adaptation and rewriting is inextricably linked with the sustainability of the copyleft movement, which calls for disbanding the copyright regime altogether.
That was Dr. K.M. Sherrif, Associate